I am here to discuss the so-called flying saucers. We can say that the recent sightings are in no way connected with any secret development by any agency of the United States.
The Washington DC sightings of July 1952, also known as the Big Flap, hold a special place in the history of unidentified flying objects. Major American newspapers were reporting multiple credible sightings by civilian and military radar operators and pilots, so many that a special intelligence unit of the US Air Force was sent in to investigate. What they found, or didn't find, along with the Air Force's official explanation, fueled some of the earliest conspiracy theories about a government plot to hide evidence of alien life.
Section 51.
Hi everyone, what's up guys, Dos Geek here with Section 51, thanks again for your support. Before starting, please hit that like button and share this new video right now to keep supporting Section 51. The 1952 Washington DC UFO incident, also known as the Washington Flap, or the Washington National Airport sightings, was a series of unidentified flying object reports from July the 19th to July the 29th, 1952, over Washington DC. The most publicized sightings took place on consecutive weekends, July 19 to 20 and July 26 to 27. At 40 past 11 p.m. on Saturday, July the 19th, 1952, Edward Nugent, an air traffic controller at Washington National Airport, today Ronald Reagan Washington National Airport, spotted seven objects on his radar. The objects were located 15 miles, around 24 kilometers, south to southwest of the city. No known aircraft were in the area and the objects were not following any established flight paths. Nugent's superior, Harry Barnes, a senior air traffic controller at the airport, watched the objects on Nugent's radar scope. He later wrote,
"We knew immediately that a very strange situation existed. Their movements were completely radical compared to those of ordinary aircraft."
Barnes had two controllers check Nugent's radar. They found that it was working normally. Barnes then called National Airport's other radar center. The controller there, Howard Coughlin, told Barnes that he also had the objects on his radar scope. Furthermore, Coughlin said that by looking out of the control tower window, he could see one of the objects, a bright orange light. He had no explanation for what he was observing. At this point, other objects appeared in all sectors of the radar scope, and when they moved over the White House and the United States Capitol, Barnes called Andrews Air Force Base, located 10 miles from National Airport. Although Andrews reported that they had no unusual objects on their radar, an airman soon called the base's control tower to report the sighting of a strange object. Airman William Brady, who was in the tower, then saw an object which appeared to be like an orange ball of fire trailing a tail, something unlike anything he had ever seen before. As Brady tried to alert the other personnel in the tower, the strange object took off at an unbelievable speed. Meanwhile, another person in the National Airport control tower reported seeing an orange disc about 3,000 feet altitude. On one of the airport's runways, S.C. Pierman, a Capital Airlines pilot, was waiting in the cockpit of his DC-4 for permission to take off. After spotting what he believed to be a meteor, he was told that the control tower's radar had picked up unknown objects closing in on his position. Pierman observed six objects, white, tailless, fast-moving lights, over a 14-minute period. Pierman was in radio contact with Barnes during his sighting, and Barnes later related,
"Each sighting coincided with a signal we could see near his plane. When he reported that the light streaked off at a high speed, it disappeared on our scope."
At Andrews AFB, meanwhile, the control tower personnel were tracking on radar what some thought to be unknown objects. But others suspected, and in one instance were able to prove, were simply stars and meteors. However, Staff Sergeant Charles Davenport observed an orange-red light to the south. The light would appear to stand still, then make an abrupt change in direction and altitude. This happened several times. At one point, both radar centers at National Airport and the radar at Andrews AFB were tracking an object hovering over a radio beacon. The object vanished in all three radar centers at the same time. At 3 a.m., shortly before two jet fighters from Newcastle AFB in Delaware arrived over Washington, all the objects vanished from the radar at National Airport. However, when the jets ran low on fuel and left, the objects returned, which convinced Barnes that the UFOs were monitoring radio traffic and behaving accordingly. The objects were last detected by radar at 5:30 a.m. Around sunrise, E.W. Chambers, a civilian radio engineer in Washington's suburbs, observed five huge disks circling in a loose formation. They tilted upward and left on a steep ascent. The sightings of July the 19th to the 20th, 1952, made front page headlines in newspapers around the nation. A typical example was the headline from the Cedar Rapids Gazette in Iowa. It read, "Saucers swarm over Capitol," in large black type. By coincidence, USAF Captain Edward J. Ruppelt, the supervisor of the Air Force's Project Blue Book investigation into UFO sightings, was in Washington at the time. However, he did not learn about the sightings until Monday, July the 21st, when he read the headlines in a Washington area newspaper. After talking with intelligence officers at the Pentagon about the sightings, Ruppelt spent several hours trying to obtain a staff car to investigate the sightings, but was refused as only generals and senior colonels could use staff cars. He was told that he could rent a taxi cab with his own money. By this point, Ruppelt was so frustrated that he left Washington and flew back to Blue Book's headquarters at Wright-Patterson AFB in Ohio. Before leaving Washington, Ruppelt did speak with an Air Force radar specialist, Captain Roy James, who felt that unusual weather conditions could have caused the unknown radar targets. A rather bizarre explanation. At 8:15 p.m. on Saturday, July the 26th, 1952, a pilot and stewardess on a National Airlines flight into Washington observed some strange lights above their plane. Within minutes, both radar centers at National Airport and the radar at Andrews AFB were tracking more unknown objects. A master sergeant at Andrews visually observed the objects. He later said that these lights did not have the characteristics of shooting stars. There was no trail, and they were traveling faster than any shooting star he had ever seen. Meanwhile, Albert M. Chop, the press spokesman for Project Blue Book, arrived at National Airport and, due to security concerns, denied several reporters' requests to photograph the radar screens. He then joined the radar center personnel. By this time, at 9:30 p.m., the radar center was picking up unknown objects in every sector. At times, the objects traveled slowly, at other times they reversed direction and moved across the radar scope at speeds calculated at 7,000 miles per hour. At 11:30 p.m., two jet fighters from Newcastle AFB in Delaware arrived over Washington. Captain John McHugo, the flight leader, was vectored towards the radar blips but saw nothing, despite repeated attempts. However, his wingman, Lieutenant William Patterson, did see four white glows and chased them. Suddenly, the glows appeared to turn and surround his fighter. Patterson asked the control tower at National Airport what he should do. The tower's answer was stunned silence. According to Patterson, the four glows then sped away from his jet and disappeared. After midnight on July the 27th, Major Dewey Fournette, Project Blue Book's liaison at the Pentagon, and Lieutenant John Holcomb, a US Navy radar specialist, arrived at the radar center at National Airport. During the night, Lieutenant Holcomb received a call from the Washington National Weather Station. They told him that a slight temperature inversion was present over the city. But Holcomb felt that the inversion was not nearly strong enough to explain the good and solid returns on the radar scopes. Fournette relayed that all those present in the radar room were convinced that the targets were most likely caused by solid metallic objects. There had been weather targets on the scope too, he said, but this was a common occurrence and the controllers were paying no attention to them. Two more jets from Newcastle AFB were scrambled during the night. One pilot saw nothing unusual. The other pilot moved towards a white light which vanished when he closed in. A Capital Airlines flight leaving Washington spotted odd lights which remained visible for about 12 minutes. As on July the 20th, the sightings and unknown radar returns ended at sunrise. The sightings of July the 26th to the 27th also made front page headlines and even led President Harry Truman to personally call Captain Ruppelt and ask for an explanation of the sightings. Ruppelt, remembering the conversation he had with Captain James, told the president that the sightings might have been caused by temperature inversion, in which a layer of warm, moist air covers a layer of cool, dry air closer to the ground. This condition can cause radar signals to bend and give false returns. However, Ruppelt had not yet interviewed any of the witnesses or conducted a formal investigation. We can say that this is a rather simplistic explanation for a phenomenon of a large scale with many witnesses. Why did Ruppelt proceed in this way by minimizing the phenomenon with the president? Let's suppose that this theory of phenomena caused by temperature inversion is indeed possible. It remains nevertheless very rare and exceptional phenomena. How is it naturally possible that such rare phenomena have occurred multiple times over the two weekends and over such a long period of time? What are the odds of that happening? I would say the odds are almost zero. And I would even add that Ruppelt may have tried to bury the case. But why? Or maybe I'm wrong. But let's continue. CIA historian Gerald Haynes, in his 1997 History of the CIA's Involvement with UFOs, also mentions Truman's concern.
A massive buildup of sightings over the United States in 1952, especially in July, alarmed the Truman administration. On 19 and the 20th of July, radar scopes at Washington National Airport and Andrews Air Force Base tracked mysterious blips. On the 27th of July, the blips reappeared.
White House concern may possibly have resulted in an order to shoot down the UFOs, reported in various international news service stories on July the 29th, 1952. One such story reported that jet pilots have been placed on a 24-hour nationwide alert against the flying saucers with orders to shoot them down if they ignore orders to land. However, Air Force headquarters also put out statements that the unidentified flying objects were no threat to the United States and not controlled by a reasoning body. Among the witnesses who supported the explanation of temperature was the crew of a B-25 bomber, which had been flying over Washington during the sightings of July 26 to 27. The bomber was vectored several times by National Airport over unknown targets on the airport's radar scopes, yet the crew could see nothing unusual. Finally, as a crew member related, the radar had a target which turned out to be the Wilson Line steamboat trip to Mount Vernon. The radar was sure as hell picking up the steamboat. The general conclusion of the US Air Force, as publicly expressed by General Samford, was that a temperature inversion had been indicated in almost every instance when the unidentified radar targets or visual objects had been reported. In later years, two prominent UFO skeptics, Dr. Donald Menzel, an astronomer at Harvard University, and Philip Klass, a senior editor for Aviation Week magazine, would also argue in favor of the temperature inversion or mirage hypothesis. But eyewitnesses, UFO researchers, and Air Force personnel came forward to criticize the temperature inversion mirage explanation. And the United States Weather Bureau also disagreed with the temperature inversion hypothesis, one official stating that such an inversion ordinarily would appear on a radar screen as a steady line rather than as a single object as were sighted on the airport radar scope. Also, according to Ruppelt, when he was able to interview the radar and control tower personnel at Washington National Airport, not a single person agreed with the Air Force explanation. There were also witnesses who claimed to see structured craft and not merely glows or bright lights. On July the 19th, an Army artillery officer, Joseph Gigandet, was sitting on the front porch of his home in Alexandria, Virginia, across the Potomac River from Washington. At 9:30 p.m., he claimed to see a red cigar-shaped object which sailed slowly over his house. Dr. James E. McDonald, a physicist at the University of Arizona and a prominent ufologist in the 1960s, did his own analysis of the Washington sightings. After interviewing four pilot eyewitnesses and five radar personnel, McDonald argued that the Air Force explanation was physically impossible. To date, there are no photos or film available from radar screen showing these UFOs. However, a photo that has now become famous on the internet shows the Capitol overflown by a dozen luminous balls. It turns out that these lights would only be the reflection on the lens of the lampposts of the Capitol. There is a video also showing lights moving horizontally. This video shows the same number of lights as in the photo, and these would be arranged in the same way in the photo and in the video. So this would demonstrate that the photo was extracted from the video, where the lights are located in space and not on a pane of glass. Is this video authentic or a hoax? So it appears that these UFO sightings really happened, and it wasn't not just a simple inversion of temperature as the American authorities would have made people believe. But what were these UFOs? Did these UFOs have an extraterrestrial or earthly origin? Was it a secret military experiment? If so, what was the point of conducting this kind of risky experiment over the city of Washington, the capital of one of the greatest military nations on the planet? It remains a military strategy difficult to understand. That's why I would be more inclined to the hypothesis of flying objects of extraterrestrial origin. What do you think? Maybe the aliens were out on the weekend to party? Please let me your reactions in the comments of this video. If one of the most famous UFO observation cases like that of Washington in 1952 was as quick to bury by the military authorities, maybe it is because some very high-ranking persons were informed of this kind of phenomenon and wanted to keep them a secret. Strangely, other sightings of major UFOs were to occur a few months later, the same year in the North Atlantic during Operation Mainbrace. Is there any connection between these incidents? Maybe someday we will know the end of the story of the Washington UFO incident. Maybe one day the long-awaited great disclosure will reveal what really appeared in the sky of Washington in July 1952. Section 51 is on social networks, Facebook, Instagram, Twitter. Hit that like button and that bell button too. Share the video, subscribe to the channel, talk about Section 51 around you. Thank you. This was Dos Geek with Section 51. I'll be back really soon. Open your eyes, watch the sky, live long and prosper.
I am here to discuss the so-called flying saucers. The Air Force's interest in this problem has been due to our feeling of an obligation to identify and analyze to the best of our ability anything in the air that may have the possibility of threat or menace to the United States. In pursuit of this obligation, since 1947, we have received and analyzed between 1 and 2,000 reports that have come to us from all kinds of sources. Of this great mass of reports, we have been able adequately to explain the great bulk of them, explain them to our own satisfaction. We've been able to explain them as hoaxes, as erroneously identified friendly aircraft, as meteorological or electronic phenomena, or as light aberrations. However, there have been a certain percentage of this volume of reports that have been made by credible observers of relatively incredible things. It is this group of observations that we now are attempting to resolve. Our basic difficulty in dealing with these is that there is no measurement of them that makes it possible for us to put them in any pattern that would be profitable for a deliberate, custom sort of analysis to take the next step. We have, as of date, come to only one firm conclusion with respect to this remaining percentage, and that is that it does not contain any pattern of purpose or of consistency that we can relate with any conceivable threat to the United States. Is that? We can say that the recent sightings are in no way connected with any secret development by any department of the United States. We can say that the recent sightings are in no way connected with any secret development by any agency of the United States.
Watch me for the signal here, sir, to start.
I'll start when you throw it down.
Hold it, boys.
Yeah. Major Keyhole, as author of the book Flying Saucers Are Real, what is your opinion of these new sightings of unidentified objects?
With all due respect to the Air Force, I believe that some of them will prove to be of interplanetary origin. During a 3-year investigation, I found that many pilots have described objects of substance and high speed. One case, pilots reported their plane was buffeted by an object which passed them at 500 miles an hour. Obviously, this was a solid object, and I believe it was from outer space.